our 10 short take on the modern pentathlon.
Yes, we have dancing from Rio.
We've got special tribute from Team GB medalists. There they are.
Fabulous security from
Here's the one for you. We've got gardening from John Humphreys.
Can you believe it? And finally, swashbuckling from the very sharp film star, Sean Bean.
Into here, Sean. We're talking of the pentathlon. You would have been quite good at that because we understand that you got medals for fencing at RADA.
Yeah, I did. I got two medals a long time ago.
Yeah,
it was good. Yeah, I was all right at fencing.
Was that épée or sabre? Remember? Sorry, kind of a bit technical then.
Just it was, what do you call it? Rapier and dagger.
Oh, right.
Yeah,
okay. Good.
And small sword.
Indeed. Right. And obviously the horse riding as well.
And so the horse riding. Not the same time.
Well, away from fencing, now what about the Olympics? Did you get to see any events?
Yeah, I did. I watched a lot on television and, you know, I was quite gripped by it. You know, I was surprised, you know.
Wait, right.
Successful. And I went down to see some of the boxing because I'm, you know, I'm a big fan of boxing.
Right.
So I went down there, we saw 13 fights, which were, you know, a lot of fights to see on one night, you know. Three-minute rounds, but it's still a big night. But it was brilliant, packed full, great atmosphere. So I'm glad I... You know, it's in your back garden. It's good to just have the opportunity to go down and experience it.
Really. Indeed, plenty to shout about from a Yorkshire perspective as well.
Yeah.
If Yorkshire was on the, if that was a country, it would have been 12th.
Yeah, I think at one point we were about 5th, but but 12th's not bad, is it?
It's like
Brazil and Australia.
Yeah.
Do you think the Olympic show have made people prouder to be British? Do you think it's worked in that way?
Yeah, it's a very good thing, isn't it? I mean, all these people, these young people have been working for years and years just for these few minutes of time where they have to perform.
Yeah.
And it's all focused towards that. And I think it's been a magnificent effort and it's brought a tear to everybody's eye.
Did you cry when the flame went out?
Not really.
Alex, did you just go on about it all last night?
I did.
But not I did when Jessica Ennis...
It's backstory, isn't it? But all you know the struggle that they've gone through and the backstories.
Yeah.
Just to see them up there, and like you say, it's incredibly gripping.
The backstories, you know, and what they've been through and the problems and the personal problems, just to get to that point is quite incredible. So,
very much so. Well, as we said earlier, we're joined by the armed forces who served at the Olympics. So if you at home were snapped with any of them at the Games, send in your pictures to the usual address and we'll show some later, won't we?
We certainly will. Okay, now when you think that some of our amazing Olympians hadn't even taken up their sports 4 years ago, it makes their achievements even more remarkable.
Yes, but how are they actually spotted in the first place? Well, Alex Riley has been to meet the people who decide whether you at home have got what it takes.
The physical prowess of our athletes has made us a new superpower in the global sporting arena. But it was the rowing pair of Helen Glover and Heather Stanning, who became Britain's first women to win rowing gold, who really embodied Britain's new can-do sports ideology. Both were plucked from relative obscurity, and the fact that just over 4.5 years ago, Helen hadn't even set foot in a rowing boat begs the question, can we all have a go at being Olympic champions? Helen and Heather owe their success to the Team GB Start programme. Steve Redgrave's Sporting Giants has helped to broaden our talent base of sportsmen and women.
Sporting Giants is looking for tall people, and that was the only criteria. Basically, if you're tall, why not have a go and see if you can be good at one of three sports? It was volleyball, handball and rowing, and try and make it to the Olympics. And I'd done quite a lot of sport before. I'd experienced international cross country as a junior, and I'd played hockey to quite a high level. So I kind of knew had an idea of what it takes to get to the top.
What is it about your physique that makes you so good at rowing?
Well, because I'm quite tall, it means that every time I take a stroke, I can go sort of further distance in the water than someone who's slightly shorter than me.
So in terms of my physique, what do you think? Do you think I've got what it takes to become a rower?
I think you're tall enough.
Yeah.
But I do think that your legs might need a bit of work.
Okay, so Olympic gold might well remain a dream for me.
Cut back, please.
Boot yourself. Maybe I can turn talent spotter. someone who does measure up to your dream of winning gold.
Now, when it comes to the optimum physique for swimming, you don't need to look any further than Michael Phelps. He's 1 metre 95 tall, his arm span is 2 metres, and his feet are size 14.
What about you?
11.
11? Senior citizens allowed to compete in the Olympics?
If they're fast enough.
Do you want to see this body in speedos?
Clearly, scouting for sporting talent is not quite as simple as that.
My Olympic dream is dashed.
And someone who knows quite a bit more about identifying and maximising everyday people's ability is talent spotter and coach for Team GB Rowing, Paul Stannard.
We're looking from 1 in 10,000 of the UK population. We've done the maths, we know those are the sort of numbers that we're looking for. So we go out and we have 10 centres around the country looking for new talent. And Sam's a good example of someone who's come through the START programme after being tested in his local school.
I was a 20-stone 16-year-old, played cricket, football, all sorts. And for someone to come along and kind of hand-pick me and say, look, this is the one for you, this is what you could do, and really excel at was what I needed and what I wanted.
And how do you assess if somebody is naturally predisposed to being a good rower?
We do a power test and also an endurance test, and because we've got 10 years worth of data, we know what sort of scores we're looking for.
So is there a reason why somebody from a very ordinary background can't do it?
Absolutely.
To maintain Team GB's competitive advantage, Paul doesn't want to give away the exact scores he's looking for.
So if we compare your score to Sam's, you're about 50% of what he scored as a 16-year-old.
So
am I in or not? Unfortunately, I'm going to have to say no.
But if somebody's out there who really thinks they might have what it takes, what should they do?
They should go on the website, GB Rowing Team website. On the left-hand side, there's a button to start on it. Click on that button, all the information's there.
And they could be the next Helen Glover.
Indeed.
But not me. I'm just going to lie down. Can I go and lie down?
Why did he hang out with the rowers? Why didn't he go and see a high jump coach? Because he'd have been signed up for Rio by now, I'm sure of it.
Oh, yeah, well, he is very tall, isn't he?
Yeah, no, exactly. Now, Sean, I don't know if you know, but the BBC had the little thing on the website where you could put in your vital statistics and then it would come up with a sport that you were suited for. So we put yours in. We might have put a few extra pounds on, I don't know, but anyway.
No, we guess your weight, yeah, by the way. We said 14 stone.
Yeah. Well,
we didn't believe them.
We were amazed with what it came up with.
We were.
Let's have a look. It's a Ukrainian female discus throw. Natalia Vokina Semenova. There we go. So anyway,
I should be her.
Well, apparently.
Apparently, you'd be
that's
good
your
for
body
discus.
Type.
Oh right, yeah. Ladies.
But that'll be the next time in a little while.
But of course, we're hugely proud of Team GB, and behind every one of our 65 medals is a very personal story.
Indeed, so we thought it would be fitting to give some of those Olympians the opportunity to thank the people who helped them through very tough times. So please put your hands together and welcome rower Heather Stanning, and high jump player Robbie Brown. Where's your gold medal?
Helen's actually got it.
It
was in the video. Hers broke, she's got mine.
Very kind of you, giving your gold medal to Helen.
We share a lot of things, it's fine.
It was an incredible moment. I mean, the first gold for women's rowing, you went over the line there. Just describe that. Has it sunk in now for you? Because obviously straight afterwards it's a big moment. You're trying to get your feelings across. But, you know, here you are now a few days later. Can you sum it all up?
Yeah, I mean, we're so glad that our dream came true and we were able to share it with so many people. Having the Olympics at home was just fantastic for that. And I suppose it's really nice to have something to show for all the effort you've done in the last few years, and the fact it's gold is just fantastic, and we're so pleased with that.
Yeah. And your day job is actually as captain of the Royal Artillery, and we've got some lovely footage here of your colleagues in Camp Bastion celebrating your win. I think we can see it here.
7 minutes away from Olympic history.
Look at that.
Yeah, they are, with the British flag.
That's great. And they give you a lovely message, didn't they? Send it straight down the line, and John Imbedale played it to you on the pontoon.
Yeah.
Must have just brought it all.
It was just so nice, because I know they're so far from home at the moment, and they've missed out on all this Olympic spirit. So I was so glad that they were able to watch it, and they know someone who's been there and done it. So I think that's really nice.
And so that is your thank you then, it's to all the guys, isn't
yeah,
it?
Yeah, totally. I can't thank the armed forces enough, and the army especially. So definitely, that's my big thanks to them.
I think they deserve it. Achieved your dreams of a bronze medal, but a very special couple helped you to get there, didn't they? Just tell us the story.
Well, I was really struggling at the beginning of the year with transport. My car kept breaking down, all the locks went, I was having to scramble through the boot, which actually made me look like I was breaking into my own car. So I was having problem after problem with it, and they caught hold of the fact I was, you know, struggling with transport, and they contacted me directly through email, and it took me about five times to read through it. I just couldn't believe it, and they came forward and helped me financially to secure a temporary car
and
up to London.
This is Roger and Heather.
Yeah. Roger and Heather. Bowen. Just fantastic.
Now they're actually on a fishing trip at the moment, aren't they? So they can't be with us tonight, but you will give the medals to them.
I definitely will. They've helped me out fantastically, and yeah, I'll head down.
Simple as a car. I mean, you know, it sounds ridiculous, but straight away, you know, get that money, you can go to trade, and then you can get that medal. And what a huge part it was.
Oh, it was massive. It took a lot of stress off me before the games. Like, you know, I didn't have to worry about actually getting to training.
Yeah.
And it was just fantastic. It helped me loads.
Big hip hop.
Yeah. I wasn't actually quite sure. My head was underneath, so I wasn't sure if I'd won or not, or if they had scored it.
Yeah. The term Ippon was bandied around quite a lot. Just from a judoka perspective, what does Ippon actually mean?
It means that you've actually thrown someone flat on their back with impetus. So, yeah, I was unaware that I actually scored it because my head ended up slightly underneath the back of her shoulder.
Right.
So I was like, have I scored? Shall I carry on? And then it was just, the crowd were going crazy, so I thought, yeah. I think I've done it. And then
it
I all realised.
Excellent. And Robbie, you're sitting there proudly with your bronze medal around your neck as well.
Yeah.
But, I mean, you were ranked outside the top 40, weren't you, last year, which made it impossible for you to get any funding. And one guy saved you, didn't he, and helped you achieve your Olympic dream. Who was that man?
It was my coach who kind of told me just to pull my finger out a little, to be honest, and said, you know, you're better than this, you've got the talent. We need to kind of sit down and have a chat. And, you know, he said, take yourself away from the sport. And, you know, I had another offer on the top. The cars to go and actually restore classic cars, which is my other dream. And to have the offer to say, do you really want, you know, pick one, which one do you really want to do? And I came back with a vengeance to get my high jump back on track.
Jump, look at this.
Sorry, afterwards.
Yeah, that was a lovely time.
And yeah, you know, I came back and I decided this, you know, don't be afraid to fail anymore and, you know, commit to this 100% and let's see what you're capable of.
Good luck. Well, are you still into your cars now?
Yeah, still into my cars.
Have a word with Carini, he might be able to fix you.
7-year-old broken one.
Yeah. Great. Well, listen, all the very best with what you've got planned for. And, you know, if you're carrying on to Rio, then we'll keep everything crossed for you. Good luck.
Cheers.
Brilliant. Thank you very much. Now, most of us would claim we're as honest as the day is long.
Yeah, but Giles Brandreth wasn't quite so convinced, so he set up a little experiment of his own.
Camera traps are normally used to capture rare wildlife in some of the world's most remote locations. But the One Show is unleashing a battery of them